Until the 9/11 attack, the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire of 1911 was the most devastating workplace disaster in United States history. But what kind of effects were produced from this accident, and how did the fire bring attention to the lack of workers' safety and health? Before we find these answers, let's look at the history and events of the fire. Back in the early 1900s, many immigrants from foreign countries were moving to the United States. Many were looking for a place of freedom, unlike their previous homes. Others were looking for work to support their families. In New York, Ellis Island was the location of the Ellis Island Immigration Station, which allowed immigrants to enter the U.S. It was a portal into America, the land of the free. Many of the very lucky immigrants were able to find an apartment and a job once a legal citizen. In the early 20th century, New York was a lively place full of buildings, parties, and parades. In New York, the best sweatshop to work in was a Triangle Shirtwaist Factory. A sweatshop was a workplace making clothes, usually crowded, dangerous, and low-paying with no job security. But in the Triangle Factory, the rooms were large and open. In an interview about the fire, a worker named Pauline Newman recalled, "It was probably the largest shirtwaist factory in the city of New York. The rooms in the factory were not as cluttered, and the factory itself took up the top three floors of the Ash Building. The Ash Building was located in the city center on the corner of Green Street and Washington Place. It was the crown jewel to many seeking work in the big city." However, the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory was far from perfect. The employees had long hours from 6 to 9, with an average of $6 a week. The workers used the income to help support their whole families, so many relatives worked together in the factory. Most workers were women, and some were as young as 14. The managers were very strict and didn't allow conversations, bathroom breaks, or slowing down during work. In an interview of the fire, a worker named Abe Gordon recalled, "Bernstein was mean. I saw him pick up an operator by the shoulders and throw him out into the hall. Everybody kept their heads bent down over their machines." The workers were also required to be searched for stolen cloth when leaving the building, due to the fact that Isaac Harris and Max Blank, the owners, were worried that the workers had been stealing cloth from the factory. The clothing business at the time was a heated war. Isaac Harris and Max Blank knew that the shirtwaists were going out of style and their sales were dropping. To combat this decline, they increased the workload of the workers. The exhausted employees knew the treatment they were receiving was unfair, and so word spread through the workplace, whispers of a revolt against the factory and its managers. One worker named Claire Limelick was the spark for a strike. She proposed that the employees of the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory should go on a strike for better working conditions and fair pay for an honest day's work. Nearly a day later, the employees of the factory walked out, leaving their work unfinished. This was a huge risk for the workers because it meant their families would receive no income for financial support and would run the risk of starvation. The strikers at the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory also had to deal with prostitutes and others hired to viciously beat the employees on strike. Police often saw this and did nothing, even going as far as to claim that the workers attacked them. From September 1909 to March 1910, the striking continued, and with their support from the National Women's Trade Union League of America, and even Anne Morgan, daughter of one of the most powerful financiers in the country, J.P. Morgan, until finally Isaac Harris and Max Blank gave in to their demands. However, the owners did not accept their request for changing the working conditions of the factory. Saturday, March 25th, 1911. Near the end of the workday, a dropped cigarette or match caused fire in the Ash Building. The workers of the Triangle Factory began running for doors, stairs, or elevators. Isaac Harris and Max Blank, located on the 10th floor, ran to the roof and escaped onto the next door building. But with all the chaos and panic, no one told the sewing machine operators on the 9th floor about the fire. Suddenly, people began screaming and running, looking for friends, family, and places to escape. Fire quickly spread across the greasy floor and scattered scraps of cloth. Unfortunately, the doors only opened inward, trapping the workers. The usual exit, the Green Street stairway, was blocked by fire. Others fled out a window and onto the rickety fire escape that soon collapsed under the weight of workers. Some workers made it into two small passenger elevators that made about 15 to 20 trips each. Many workers leaped or were pushed into the elevator shaft from others trying to escape the fire. When all hope seemed lost, many workers began jumping out the windows in order to escape the fire. In another interview, Anna Peron said, "I never knew about the fire escape. We used to use the freight elevator only." Firemen were helpless, their water hoses and ladders only reached the seventh floor. The sheets to catch the jumpers ripped, and some even fell through the concrete sidewalk and into the service tunnels. After the fire, policemen took the bodies to the local morgue. They also had to order more coffins as there were not enough. Once the morgue was filled with bodies, a second temporary morgue was used in a small warehouse. After the chaos of the fire, a total of 146 of the nearly 400 employees either burned or fell to their deaths. Max Blank and Isaac Harris were tried for manslaughter, but the jury acquitted them. In 1913, they lost a civil suit and provided $75 per deceased victim to the plaintiffs. Blank was fined $20 for locking the door in his factory during working hours. Many disputes over employee safety and health were fought, and OSHA, or Occupational Safety and Health Association, were created to protect the rights of the employees, such as fair pay for working hours and regulation working conditions. Laws were created that made managers and owners put and maintain safety equipment such as sprinklers, fire escapes, alarms, and exits. It seems obvious today that the owners of the Triangle Shirtwaist factory should have kept well-maintained emergency provisions due to the fact that they were responsible for the workers and the building. But at the time, there were no rules or laws that made managers do this. Instead, it seemed like a waste of money. By denying the workers their right to fight for better working conditions, the owners prevented a change that they saw as unbeneficial to them because it lost profit. However, the owners also had a right to control their pay to the employees and the rules such as being searched for stolen items. In response to the unfair conditions, the workers risked starvation for them and their families by becoming responsible for the change and went out on strikes to cause the change. If only Max Blank and Isaac Harris would have accepted better working conditions and changed their safety precautions, the fire could have been a lot less devastating if it ever happened. The Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire should be remembered for the change it caused for the safety of employees everywhere. It was a huge change, and there are many places to look for information on this topic, such as Cornell University, New York Public Library, and PBS. Because of the fire, every public building now has a maintained safety system in case of an emergency. The loss of the 146 employees have saved countless lives today and in the future, and they should be remembered and respected for this.